Good afternoon, Jean-Paul Henry, third year seminarian. Today for my reflection, I will look at the second statement of Jesus on the cross. Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. When Good Friday comes around, it signals for us that the season of Lent has ended. But more importantly, it is the day that we as Christians reflect on the crucifixion of Christ upon the cross. It is a day that may invoke a feeling of sadness or even remorse as we reflect on the death of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Christ has been sentenced to death for being a teacher, for being just, for being the personification of love. And even on that day that he died at the hand of his detractors, he did not stop loving or forgiving anyone, even those same detractors that had determined that death was his fate on that day. Even on the brink of an earthly death, because while he was fully God, he was also fully human, Jesus still forgave, still petitioned for those who did not comprehend their actions. He demonstrated that the life he led was not a farce or a show put on to impress persons, to win them over, but that he was consistent with his teachings and what he stood for. We know this because of the famous seven statements of Jesus on the cross recorded within the Gospel accounts. Today, as I focus on the second statement recorded in Luke chapter 23, verse 43, to fully understand how profound this statement is, let us go back and read from verse 39 down to 43. It states, "One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, 'Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us.' But the other rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' Then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' He replied, 'Truly I tell you, you will be with me in paradise.'" Even at the time of his death, Jesus was still forgiving for the wrong that persons did to the world and to him directly. Here it is that while dying, he had to hear the same rhetoric from a non-believer. "Save yourself. If you are the Messiah, save yourself." Could Jesus not get a break, even at the last? I know I would have been fed up of hearing the same thing over and over. But when we reflect on these words today, there's an interaction taking place that many times we can take for granted. Jesus was in the presence of criminals, persons against whom a charge or charges have been directed and have been found guilty of breaking the law, whether by their own confession or judge and jury determination. Their acts have been judged to be crimes by the laws that were set out at that time. They have committed acts that are in contravention to the acceptable behaviors and practices of their communities, and as such, the law of the land states they were to be put to death. While on the crosses they were nailed to, we witness something that is easy to miss. Most of us may focus on the fact that Jesus was being unjustly treated. We may focus on the fact that the second criminal came to Jesus' defense against the taunting of the first. But I would like to point out something that I think should speak to us. The fact that even at the last, the second criminal sought absolution of his sins and is granted right before he dies on the cross. Through this interaction, we may make a connection to the sacrament of extreme unction, which became known as anointing of the sick, but more commonly today may be referred to as last rites in many communities. Because that in essence is what has happened, except for the obvious fact that the criminal did not receive an anointing on the cross. But in some of his remaining breath, he was able to demonstrate his faith in Christ. He affirmed his belief that this was the Messiah. He sought forgiveness and received the promise that there is a space in heaven for him. What is this interaction saying to us as followers of Christ today? We live in a world where freedom is the mantra. There is a constant drive for freedom from all. Freedom from obstruction, freedom of speech, freedom to be who we want when we want. We desire to be uninhibited by anything. In the midst of this freedom movement, we may often find ourselves taking a side, holding on to a perspective, and drawing a line that in our opinion should not be crossed. We may be guided by our personal moral code, our Christian teachings, our family practices, or even the norms of the society in which we live. In this year, 2020, we will have seen many new lifestyles, hear many opinions being expressed, encounter many new perspectives on life, and witness a host of new ideals, which in one way or another seem to challenge our own. But what is our response in the face of these challenges? First, we need to know that our role is not to judge. Neither can we force anyone to do what we think or want as we do. Who is to say that our lifestyle or our moral code is actually pleasing to Christ? We need to distance ourselves from the trend of judging the actions of others. As a matter of fact, I would say that we need to forget the actions of others and focus on our own. Take a deeper look at our relationship with Christ. We need to evaluate our shortcomings and seek to atone for them. These words of the second statement of Christ upon the cross speaks to everyone. It does not matter which grouping we put ourselves into. We are assured that an opportunity exists for us to make atonement for our sins. Not just the Christians, but everyone has an opportunity. Whether it be from the priest, the CEO, the doctor, the fast food worker, the child, the homeless, the drug addict, and yes, the criminal. Everyone has that opportunity to bring their shortcomings, their mistakes to Christ, and receive pardon for what they have intentionally or unintentionally done. The transgressions of the regular churchgoer are no less or no more than those of the seasoned criminal. Sin is sin. What makes the difference is being able to acknowledge that shortcoming and recognizing Christ as the Messiah, as the second criminal on the cross did on that fated day. Jesus sends the message that true repentance, the hope of salvation, exists. We do not need to have sound theology, nor do we need to be a goody two-shoes, but because of God's mercy and our faith and trust in Jesus, we will also have a place in paradise. The second criminal had one simple request: to be remembered. And receive the promise, you will be with me in paradise. Let us pray. Dear God, as we reflect upon the death of Christ upon the cross today and what it means for us, we give thanks for your mercy and grace that encourages and heals us. We give thanks for the promise that we will always have your ear when we cry out to you, that we will never be abandoned, and that there is a place in paradise for us because your mercy abounds forever. Let us not see the speck in the eye of others before we see it in our own. Today we keep trusting in you and you alone, and in the promise of your salvation. Amen. Good afternoon.
Stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. How I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. That old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. My home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
someday for a crown.
A reading from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 23, verses 39 to 43. Luke chapter 23, verses 39 to 43. One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I say to you, today, you will be with me in paradise." When I think of the two thieves that hung with Jesus on that fateful day on Calvary, a picture is painted and formed in my imagination. And when I think or picture this image, I cannot help but think of some of the lines from that contemporary gospel song. The lines go like this. There's a line that's been drawn through the ages. On that line stands the old rugged cross. On that cross, a battle is raging for the gain of man's soul or its loss. And as I think of these words, I cannot help but see this image in my mind, a beautiful image, yet at the same time, a dreadful image, the image of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, beaten, bruised, bloodied, and exposed to the elements, nailed to a hard wooden cross. As Christ hangs there, the skies overhead are darkening, and it's almost as if I can feel a breeze, or at least a chill in the air. On this hill, there are onlookers, no doubt the Blessed Mother weeping and wailing, shocked and in complete disbelief as her child, her innocent child, is given a criminal's death. The disciples, helpless and powerless as their fearless leader who once turned water into wine, who once fed the 5,000, who even raised Lazarus from the dead, and he healed many, and he having power even over the demons. He's hanging there, naked, filthy, weak, battered. They too stand by, simply watching. On his left and on his right, there hang two deserving criminals. Two who had the fortune of not only dying as our Savior was dying, but dying alongside him. One of the criminals jeers at him, and they ask him, "Are you not the Christ? And if so, do something about this situation. Save us, or at least save yourself." Yet he remains silent. The other thief understands the man with whom he is next to, and he begs him, "Remember me when you come into the kingdom." This, my brothers and sisters, this is the war that waged on that glorious day, that dreadful day. A war between those who believed and those who did not. It was a war between those who recognized God and those who would dare to insult him. Hanging in the balance was the Christ. Before I go any further, I want us to consider the way in which our Lord hung on that day. His arms were outstretched. Often I've heard persons using this imagery to say that Christ, in dying in this manner with his arms outstretched, he died to welcome those of us who have and who continue to go astray. He died to welcome us back into the fold. However, I want to paint another image for us today. When I think of this image of Christ with his arms outstretched, I cannot help but think of Moses in Exodus chapter 17, when the Israelites battled the Amalekites. And as long as Moses' arms were raised, the battle was always in favor of Israel, God's chosen people. Christ, like Moses, had his arms outstretched. And as long as his arms remain outstretched and nailed to that cross, the devil was defeated. And so our Lord hung there, arms up and outstretched, arms nailed in that position by grace and by mercy for you and for me, undeserving as we are. He did it just for us. Today we don't have to live defeated, and we don't have to live oppressed. Why? Because Christ had his arms outstretched, and he had them outstretched that you and I could have the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. And as Christ hung there, the war raged. As this war went on, one of the thieves allowed the devil to use him to taunt and to tease Jesus. Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. Now, mind you, what this man was saying was true. Jesus was the Christ, and he indeed could have saved himself. But that was not the will of God. That was simply the easy way out, but it was not the right way. How many of us are presented with the easy way out, the alternative way? How many of us are given the option of the path that is not in accordance with the will of God? As this battle for humanity waged, Christ had to remain obedient. We too must remain obedient. Every day, the devil is trying his best to persuade us to take the easy way out, to go against God's will. We see the manifestation of this permeating our society. Persons, they turn to drugs, to alcohol, to sex. They turn to friends and to toxic relationships to ease the pain. When in reality, they only provide temporary pleasure. And in turn, we forsake permanent and inner healing that can only come through Almighty God. Too many times we try to heal the body when it is our souls that need healing. We see people turning to destructive behaviors, shooting up with needles just to cope with the pain, turning to the bottle, turning to illicit sex, turning to money, turning to frivolous things of this world, turning to people who mean them no good, who only seek to hurt and exploit them. And they turn. Why? Because life, like the thief, the devil is there, trying his best to get us to take the easy way out, to do it on our own and not rely solely on the saving power of God. Instead, we must follow the directive of Matthew chapter 6 and 33, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. The other thief had it right. We must seek God and his kingdom and all other needs, desires, wants, and all of the areas of our lives that seem to lack, the voids, the empty places, they will be filled. They will be taken care of. This world and its offerings, they cannot fully satisfy us. Money, homes, cars, promotions, clothes, they cannot fill the void that Christ fills. And so we must not seek to take this easy way out. When we examine Jesus' response to the thief, we see that it is the model we must all follow. And that was that Jesus remained silent. In this silence, the power of God spoke for itself. Christ wasn't going to do it on his own, but only through the power of God, so that God's work may be brought to completion. How many of us try to do it on our own and not rely on God? We try to solve our problems alone. We try to bear our burdens alone. We try to fix our own wrongs. We try to make penance ourselves. Why? Sometimes we must simply be still. We must simply be still and know that He is God. A part of our problem is that we try to act too soon, do too much, too quickly. We try to do God's work when in fact we are not God. Jesus remained silent and he allowed God to work on his behalf. He didn't try to take the easy way out, didn't try to do it all on his own. So I ask you today, what is it that you've been wrestling with? What insecurities have you been trying to fix by yourself? What battles have you been fighting? As Christians, we always seem to have a battle going on in our mind. The world telling us one thing and the will of God demanding something else. But let me remind you, the battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. And in the midst of our battles, the devil is there, offering us beautiful and intriguing opportunities, luring us into traps and down paths that lead to ultimate destruction. What battle are you currently going through? Surrender it all to God. Stop trying to fix it on your own and in your own strength. Turn your eyes up to God. Look to Him. Seek his face. 1 Chronicles chapter 16 and 11 tells us to look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. You don't have to do this on your own. You don't have to yield to the trials and challenges that are coming your way. Simply rest in the presence of Almighty God. Leave it all to Jesus. Surrender it all to him. Give it all to Jesus. Lay down your burdens at the altar. There's no reason to walk this journey burdened and weighed down. One of my favorite hymns is a testimony to this. Shackled by a heavy burden, neath the load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. He touched me, oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Allow the hand of Almighty God and his Son Jesus Christ to touch you, renew you, strengthen you, and keep you. While this portrait of Jesus hanging between two thieves paints a picture of the battle of humanity, with the devil on one side trying to break Jesus, we now draw our attention to the second thief. Jesus hanging there represented us, torn between two thieves, one who tries to lead us astray and the second who has his eye on the prize. The second thief rebuked the first, and he recognized Jesus for who he was, the Savior of the world, whose purpose was on that cross. But more importantly, as the one who was paving the way for those who believed in him to get his or her just reward. The first thief tried his best to wear Jesus down. The second one reminded him that when this cross was gone, there would be a kingdom. In other words, this cross would be exchanged for a crown. I believe that Jesus, tired, weary, weak, forsaken, battered, and bruised, he was ready to give up and to give in. Yet in the midst of this, the other thief asked him to remember him when he came into his kingdom. The thief reminded Jesus indirectly that his reward was just around the corner. And Jesus hung in there, suffered, and bled. Let me remind you today that the harder the battle, the sweeter the victory. Never give up. As you, like Jesus, hang in the balance with defeat, frustration, and depression on one side, remember that victory is on the other side. Don't lose heart. This world is not your home. You're only passing through. As the song says, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We will sing and shout the victory. My brothers and sisters, let me encourage you with the words of Paul to the Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and verse 18. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Paul says that I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. In other words, heaven will surely be worth it all. We endure these things here on earth because we know that in Christ Jesus we will be remembered and welcomed in the kingdom, as told in Revelation to John chapter 21 verses 1 to 4. You see, John saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. John saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, and it was prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And then John heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. My friends, we can rest assured that when we remain faithful, even in the midst of all that is going wrong, we will be rewarded. And it's not a reward that can be destroyed by moth and rust, but with the ultimate reward that even the devil himself cannot tamper. We will be remembered in the kingdom. And so, my brothers and sisters, humanity hung in the balance. And at the core of this humanity was our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, arms outstretched in victory, held there by grace and mercy, so that you and I might receive redemption, payable only and exclusively by the blood of the Lamb of God, the Lamb which takes away the sins of the world. And as the battle raged and all manner of evils sought to defeat our Savior, he relied on the strength of God to sustain him, knowing fully his purpose. He did not give in, and sought to remedy the situation that he found himself in. Christ modeled this, that we too may always seek the strength of the Lord no matter what situation we find ourselves in. It was in this perseverance that he then was reminded of the joyful reward which awaited his faithfulness, that reward being the kingdom of heaven. We too then must persevere. We run the race that is set before us, keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, because we know that we have a home, not made with hands, eternal in the heavens, and that where our Savior is, we too may enter. We persevere so that on that last day we can hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of your rest. Therefore, I encourage you, hold on. Hold on and never let go. You are not defeated. You are victorious. Hold on knowing that Christ is holding on to you. I am reminded and encouraged by the very words of the hymn that I quoted at the beginning of this sermon, of this reflection. And so I leave some of those words from the first verse with you. There's a line that's been drawn through the ages. On that line stands the old rugged cross. On that cross, a battle is raging for the gain of man's soul or its loss. On one side march the forces of evil, all the demons and devils of hell, on the other the angels of glory, and they meet on Golgotha's hill. The earth shakes with the force of the conflict. The sun refuses to shine, for there hangs God's Son in the balance.
You see, there's a line that's been drawn down through the ages. On that line, there stands an old rugged cross. And on that cross, there's a battle, and it's raging for the gain of man's soul or his loss. On one side, there marches all the forces of evil, all the demons, and all the devils of hell. All but friend, on the other, the angels of glory, and they meet on Golgotha's hill. The earth shakes with the force of the conflict, and the sun refuses to shine. For there hangs God's Son in the balance, and then through the darkness he cries,
it is finished, the battle is over, it is finished, there be no more.
The battle was still raging. Not all prisoners of war had come home, for these were battlefields of my own making. I didn't know that the war had been won. Oh, but then I heard that the King of the Ages had fought all life's battles for.